Hello, welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. My guest today, Matthew Spector, has written American Dream Machine. It's published by Tin House, and it is a book that will hold you and tell you really who are the people who control Hollywood. No, it's no one you expect. It's the agents. Welcome, Matthew.
Hi, Connie. Thanks for having me.
And it is the Hollywood of the agents, the ones who make the deals, the ones whose girls are always the most attractive, even if not the brightest.
That's a good question, though. You just suggested that the agents are the people who control Hollywood, and I think that that's a question that the book kind of opens up. You know, questions who does control Hollywood? You know, and by extension, sort of that slice of American culture and that slice of American unconscious life. It may be the agents. It may be somebody else.
Well, in reading this book, there's a man, the hero, Bo, and he's sort of the opposite of being a hero, but he is.
He's, I don't know that I would call him an anti-hero. I mean, he certainly has, he has a very rich palette of human characteristics, right? There are things about him that are...
He's not tall.
No.
He is bald.
Well,
he's getting there. And he's aware of his failings, but he thinks, almost like Mother loved me, but she died, he thinks he can overcome anything.
And he almost does, perhaps.
Yeah.
Or at least he does a good job with his with the complicated hand that he's dealt. I'll put
All
it
right.
that way.
Who hires him first?
Who hires him first?
Mm-hmm.
He gets hired in the mid-1950s to go to work for a fictitious talent agency in New York called Talented Artists Group. And he goes to work for a man named Abe Waxmorton, who is sort of an old, elegant, you know, sort of elegant old mogul, you know, sort of maybe loosely modeled on someone
from
Lou
William
Wasserman.
Morris.
Right, Lou
yeah.
Wasserman.
Or Lou
sure.
Wasserman, right.
Right, exactly.
And... he's sent out to Hollywood.
Exactly. That's the great American story, right? Go
yes.
West. Go West, young man.
And he does very well. So well, they send him back to New York, and while he's there, he meets a woman who is a literary agent.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And she's unique.
Yeah. Rachel.
Yeah.
Yeah. His
And Rachel is
wife.
Not what you expect a literary agent to be. I mean, she's not dressed chic, with chicness or style. All she does is read. I must say I identified with her on that. But Bo looks at her and says, I'm going to be back. And he is. And he does. She becomes impregnated. And she delivers twins.
Right.
And they get married.
Right.
And then she says, you take care of the kids. And he's more than happy to.
Yep. And all this in the first, this is, you know, the first sliver of the book, really.
Yeah. Yeah. And from there, what happens?
Well, from there, he's become a producer at this point, right? Now we're talking about the early 1970s, and he has his two kids that he's looking after in the Hollywood of the, you know, very early 70s, sort of the new Hollywood at this point, the sort of, you know, Easy Rider, you know, kind of period, the Hal Ashby period. Not the most, not necessarily the easiest world for a child to grow up in. I mean, that is, you know, I that's loosely the Hollywood that I grew up in. And you really want me to say what happens?
yeah. But why wasn't it easy?
Well, I mean, I think it was certainly a very, you know, lively historical time. You know, there was sort of the culture of the 60s had sort of come through. So there was a, you know, a certain relaxation about attitudes about drugs and, you know, things that sort of bled into, you know, my own adolescent and even pre-adolescent life and you know, does so for the children in the book as well, for sure.
But you did mention to me you went to a school called Crossroads.
I did, yeah.
That was very progressive. And yet, I'm sure there was, you had drugs there, but I'm sure they weren't heavy drugs.
Yeah, well, they may have been heavy drugs at times, but there was also a very rich intellectual culture, and that was the interesting tension of Los Angeles in the 70s and 80s to me, and that's also a tension that gets played out in the book. There was a very rich, you know, I had a very, very strong education, and, you know, like everybody that I knew, there was, you know, a very strong, very arts-oriented education. So, you know, there was a very active pursuit of cinema and of literature and an awareness, you know, not just of the things that everybody gets taught in high school. Everybody reads Steinbeck. Not everybody watches Antonioni movies and, you know, and reads Pynchon in
the
high school.
The Italian films.
Right.
Yeah. But they're also, Beau is part of a social world, mm-hmm. and part of it he wants to be in. And you have a scene with the children, and I told you it just destroyed me, where his twins mm-hmm. are now, what, about 8 years of age?
Mm-hmm.
They're with him out to the beach
right.
and out in Malibu, and the kids are sort of shunted aside while the grown-ups are doing whatever they want to do.
Right.
And while the kids are there, the boy whose father owns the place has a gun.
Mm-hmm.
And
there's an accident.
And it goes off.
Right.
And Kate, the daughter of the twins, is killed.
Right.
And it's as if, how do you go on? But Bo does go on.
Well, that was something. I mean, I'm a parent. I have a daughter who's about that age, and obviously that was a tough scene to write, and a tough thing to visit upon the protagonist of your book. But at the same time, you know, I guess I was interested in how people do, and certainly interested too in, you know, Bo is a character because he's so. You know, he's not physically attractive, but he is tremendously charismatic, tremendously mm-hmm. driven, you know, and also someone I felt from the outset, you know, the reader isn't any more than the narrator. He isn't a character that you necessarily clutch to your heart the moment that you see him. And I feel like that particular juncture in the book, which is, again, relatively early. I mean, there's so much that happens after that, but... you know, that was a very humanizing moment. I mean, I think that's where both the character and the book hopefully get very deep and stay deep.
He also is involved after the film, which isn't a great success. He's back being an agent again.
Right.
And there's a man he works for, Sam, who treats him like dirt.
Yeah.
And Bo takes it up to a point.
Right.
And then there is the time he goes into Sam's office, and Sam says, you can't go back to New York. It's over.
Right.
And if you go, you're fired. And he takes Sam's most prized possession, a spittoon that was given to
Claridge's
him
by
Laurence Olivier.
Yep.
And he makes it into a pot.
Yes, of sorts. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, you know, those gestures... you know, that's not a true story, but I think those
it's close.
Theatrical gestures, there have been some famous moments like that in Hollywood. Certainly there have. You know, and again, it just seemed like a moment where Bo could really express his temper.
And it does put him behind the salt, so to speak, because word gets around.
Right, right.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, there too, I think it's one of those things where, you know, people, the interesting thing about Hollywood is that it is such a, you know, it's not just a storytelling culture in terms of that's what it's, you know, that's what it does, that's what it produces, but it's also a storytelling culture in that, you know, everybody lives and dies by their legend.
And in those days, there used to be Variety and Daily, Hollywood Reporter, and there is everything that, the New York Times didn't compare to that being the first thing anyone in Hollywood read.
Right. Army Archer.
Exactly.
Yep.
And then you have the thing that the twin who was left, Severn,
mm-hmm. yep.
is badly affected, of course, by it, the loss of his sister. What he doesn't know is that he has a half brother.
Right.
Because our friend Bo was very generous with putting himself around both with his secretary and anybody else.
Sure.
And she is pregnant with her son by Bo, but she has married another agent, Teddy.
Right, right.
All of which sounds like, gee, this could be really true.
you mean literally true?
Yeah.
No, it's not. None of it. At least not Not true for me.
Then you have written it in such a wonderful way, Matthew, that it has really truth to it, or a version of truth.
Well, it may in that sense be true. I mean, I certainly think that the, you know, the sort of emotional notes of the book, they're certainly, those are certainly true for me in some sense. I couldn't possibly have written the book if they weren't. But I think, they're not biographically true for me.
Yeah. And the man, Teddy, who has been his father.
Yeah.
Is an agent also.
Yes.
But I love the fact he ends up being a top agent at the end.
Right, right. Yeah. It's, there were a lot of people in this book to keep track of. A lot of paternity, a lot of characters, a lot of fates that get kind of...
But there's another man, William Farquhar.
Farquharson, the Scottish
Farquharson.
Yeah.
I'm sure you had William Farquhar as an author from Middle English.
Right.
But... He's been an interesting, the other side of Beau.
Right, right.
One is elegant, which is William, and Beau is, was sort of like Tony Soprano.
More animal, much more raw personality.
And they go ahead as partners.
Right.
And they become at one point what would be CA, what became Creative Artists Agency.
The agency in the book is where derives its title, right? American Dream Machine. And there is, which is, the story of the foundation of that agency is not exactly the creative artist agency.
Yeah, they used somebody's garage.
Right.
The wives were there helping out. And whether they were first wives or second wives, they were there doing their job to get their husbands back on the ground.
Right, exactly.
Yep.
I certainly did borrow a little bit against the CAA mythology. You know, my father was an agent at CAA. He was not one of the founders, but he did go over fairly early. I worked at CAA in the mailroom and the coverage department when I was in high school. That was my, a summer job and an after school job for me. And so I was around not the original offices, but by the time I was at CAA, it was still quite small. It was probably about 50 people, which compared to what it is today.
Yeah. And of course, then they had the great building built by I.M. Pei.
They sure did. I remember that well as well.
Yeah.
But by that time I had gone to college. That all happened when I was a little older.
Yeah.
But the kind of formative American Dream Machine stuff and a lot of the stuff where that gets played out in the book. I put them in CAA's offices as I remembered them. But those are certainly not.
I think actually the look of the cover is the CAA offices today in Century City.
Perhaps, a little bit, right? Yeah.
But Beau and William are best of friends. They're running this new company.
Sure.
And now who's the leader? Well, it turns out it really is William, because when Beau goes off, he's told what to do. William now is the teller of what Beau should do.
Right. Well, you're right about that, but I think the interesting question about that partnership is, first of all, I feel like that partnerships do tend to fracture along those lines, not just in the agency business, but people who are very kind of complementary or opposite personality types can bond and have this kind of wonderful friendship, and you see those things fall apart all the time. Mm-hmm. To what extent, Williams is really bullying Beau, or is consciously bullying Beau? I mean, or if he's doing it at all, because the book does, raise some questions about Beau's mental and emotional state during that portion of it as well. It's sort of meant to be a somewhat open to interpretation, I think.
Now, William lives in Santa Monica with his wife, Marcy. She's an artist. And, there's a son, Will, William, or Little William, whatever they're calling him at that moment.
Uh-huh.
And he becomes very good friends with Severn and Nate.
Yeah, right.
And they become a threesome, even when the parents aren't getting along.
Right, right.
Which I was wondering about.
Uh-huh. That's a good question. I mean, I was certainly interested in the younger generation, who likewise kind of take up a large portion of the book from beginning to end. I was interested in that that particular dynamic. You know, whenever there are three friends, there's always an imbalance of power.
Two can play and three can't.
Yeah. I mean, I think, you know, it's, that may be true with even with just two younger friends, but it's definitely true with three.
Yeah.
When you have teenagers and pre-teenagers, it's always, you know, two are kind of ganging up against the other. And I found that was an interesting way of kind of, you know, exploring a power dynamic, you know, and a parallel power dynamic to the one that gets explored between the adults and the
Yeah.
Both. Yeah.
Because even with the fathers not getting along, Severin goes over and is always welcome at William's home.
Sure.
For dinner.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I think that there is something, that is also something that's probably, I think it's true to the business, and maybe, but it may also be true to some aspect of human nature that, you know, these three kids really grow up under the shadow of both fathers.
Mm-hmm.
And I think both men understand that even if they're having a business dispute, the relationship to the children doesn't change.
Oh, I don't know about that. The kids hear fathers talking at home, and that terrible man, what he did today, etc. It happens. I'm going to ask you to read, because I want them to hear how well it is written too, Matthew.
Thanks. This is a scene just from the middle of the book that involves the three boys skateboarding at an abandoned pool in the marina. Severin came up the steps finally and handed me the skateboard. Around us was all kinds of detritus. There were overturned deck chairs, a pair of painter's gloves, old newspapers. A flyer protesting Prop 13 was up in one of the windows of the empty units behind us. I took the board and descended into the pool. The sun burned fiercely, almost white, and the wind stirred the long grasses on the hillside beneath us. My nose filled with the brackish smell of sea air. Finally, I stumbled off the skateboard. I was nowhere near as good as Little Will, but I could hold my own, and climbed back out over the coping. I'd banged my knee, aggravated my ankle. What are you looking at? I limped around now to join my friends where they sat astride the diving platform that hung over the deep end. Between them was an old issue of Daily Variety. God knew where it had come from. Its pages were water-warped and wind-creased. Severin shrugged, a little twitch of languid resignation. He and Little Will sat hunched over it like chess players facing one another. Sev's back was to the pool. He handed it to me. Our fathers were on the front page, above the fold. The article was 6 weeks old, but it noted their agency had grossed $49 million last year, more than the other top two agencies combined. They're everywhere, Little Will said. Yep. Sev took the paper back. It drifted out of his fingers and fell to the bottom of the pool. No escape. 1982. That was the difference between us. My friends couldn't escape, whereas I was at a loss. Beau was in both of their lives. Even young Williams had more of his attention, the partner's son, than I did. That's how it felt, and in many ways, this painful fact would direct the course of my adulthood.
Yeah. That's, how did it affect his adulthood?
the narrator in that scene and the narrator throughout the book is Nate, is Beau's illegitimate son. And that's an excellent question. I mean, Nate is the character who is a... he's certainly not me, but he is, you know, a kind
people
of...
People you've known.
He's probably the most autobiographically drawn of those characters. And, and as we were discussing before, you know, my father doesn't really resemble the father in the book, doesn't resemble Beau very much. And you know, I was acknowledged since birth. But I think, just to answer, how did it direct his adult? I think, you know, Nate grows up to become a kind of a self-loathing screenwriter and also the author of this book implicitly. So, you know, someone who's a little bit torn between literature and the movie business, like me, and you know, and someone who has to work that out, who has to work out, you know, the fact of a kind of love-hate relationship with his parent and with his hometown and with his culture. And I think that's a pretty common human predicament. I mean, we're
especially
all kind of directed by that.
Especially if you have a successful father.
Right.
A dynamic personality.
Right.
Very emasculating to a son. I don't mean you per se.
Yeah, I know.
The situation.
Right.
And then, of course, when they are, I mean, again, fantastic drama.
Uh-huh.
Monica has taken the three boys. I'm going to teach you guys about country and being outdoor people.
Right.
And they come back, and she can't reach her husband.
Mm-hmm.
And then they hear the news on the radio.
Right.
William has disappeared.
Correct.
He's been mysterious. No, there's no reason for him to be leaving the country, but he can't. And then, of course, after the funeral,
right,
they find out the truth.
Right. Well, they don't find out the truth for some time.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, you know, he is categorized as missing and remains missing for some
yeah.
time. And again, that just seemed to me like something that...
Well, I think even as you were writing this,
yeah.
not that it was the facts were the same, there was some guy from, I think, 20th century who was missing.
Exactly. Right.
Yeah.
Right. Exactly. So, you know, of course I had a memory of that. And, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But, I mean, the book had already been written by
right.
the time that happened, so
yeah.
it was life imitating art.
Yeah. But also I think there is, I mean, again, I think that you know, this isn't particularly Hollywood specific. I mean, I think, you know, adults sometimes do, and there's a lot of adult disappearance in this novel. You know, they disappear mm. from each other's lives, that
yeah.
Severin's mother disappears.
Except that she was still in touch with Severin.
Right, right.
I mean,
yeah.
you kept saying he was writing to Seattle,
yep.
and you just knew that Rachel would be that person.
Right, right, right.
Yeah.
Right. And ultimately it is revealed that that's who it was, but
yeah.
but it's not spelled out that it could be. He has an alibi.
But it's interesting how you have the boys as men
mm-hmm.
outliving the parents, outliving Beau and
yeah.
the generation.
Sure, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, that is usually what happens, right?
I know, but it's not usual for a writer to allow the reader
mm-hmm.
to
right.
go that far.
Right, right, to go ahead of
yeah.
the protagonist, even if just a little bit.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's true. And but you know, I feel in a lot of ways like the younger generation is where the meaning of Beau's story, you know, Beau's story is, you know, sort of full of drama, but it's
yeah.
its suggestiveness and its implications are really felt in, you know, through the younger generation.
Did any of those three
mm-hmm.
have a career in Hollywood other than the unhappy writer?
Oh, I think they. I don't think Little Will does. He's completely non-pro.
Yeah.
But Severin and Nate both have a career in Hollywood.
Yeah.
They certainly do. That'll get.
And Severin, mm-hmm. or is it? They keep thinking of themselves, and it's wonderful, as brothers.
Right.
You know, Nate resents that he didn't have his father in the early years the way Beau does.
Right. Right.
But it's they're brothers.
Yeah, well, they are. And I think,
yeah.
you know, when you have that kind of friendship, when you're really, you know, when you grow up with someone or you're, I certainly had that experience. You know,
yeah.
I had a couple of close friends when I was little, and they were, you know, a big part of my life in that way.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I think that question of, you know, they all seem like brothers, whether
yeah.
they're related or not related. You know, Severin and Little Will seem as related as...
Yeah.
As anyone does with Nate.
What will the next book be?
I've just begun it. It is set, small portions of it are set in Los Angeles, but there
mm-hmm.
it seems now to have several different parts that are set in, you know, different corners of the world. It's a very different feeling book to me.
Matthew, we also should tell our friends in the audience that you are the founder, or one of the founders, of LA Review of Books.
Yes, yes, one of the founders of the Los Angeles
yeah.
Review of Books.
How did
yeah.
that come about?
Well, my there's a fellow named Tom Lutz, who's a professor at UC Riverside, who was the man with the original brilliant idea, and Tom came to me one day and said, you know. There's a New York Review of Books, there's a London Review of Books.
Yeah.
Los Angeles is a fantastic literary city. It's one of the largest book markets in the country.
I know.
Why is there no Los Angeles
yeah.
Review of Books? And you know, we looked at each other and we just thought, well, I don't know.
Yeah.
So the two of us, a woman named Lisa Jane Persky, a fellow named Evan Kindley, and a woman named Julie Klein. That was the original
yeah.
five people. There are many, many other people who have...
Do you publish a paper?
We do now, yeah. We started as online only, and I would encourage anybody who's interested, which, you know, hopefully is everybody listening. Yeah, anybody with a laptop and an internet connection, www.lareviewofbooks.org. Have a look. It's really quite a wonderful, you know, we have fantastic writers, not just from Los Angeles, but obviously from all over the world at this point writing. Yeah.
And Matthew, will you sign my book?
With pleasure.
Because I love books.
Thank you, Connie.
And if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.conniemartinson.com, and you can read our columns from the Beverly Hills Courier. Or you can visit us at YouTube on Connie Martinson's channel that has all of the recent shows. If you want to go back and really see some of the early shows with Gore Vidal, with Amand Oz, go to Claremont Graduate University Digital Library, Peter Drucker Institute. They have taken, I donated, they took them and digitized the first 2,000 shows. It's really quite wonderful to put someone's name in and see what they were saying in 1994. One being Barack Obama. Meanwhile, support your local library. Libraries are our finest democratic institution in America. Anyone can go into a library and get a library card and even be helped to learn how to read or read better. Have a problem with your eyesight? They will have bigger print. And they will also have books on tape. And whatever you can do, support them. Bring a child with you. Get them their first library card. They will never forget you, and it's the best legend anyone can leave. And we'll see you next time. Thank you, Matt.
Thanks, Connie.